Okay, maybe this will work this time. Just maybe, anyway. Another thing I wanted to do real quick. Almost forgot to do it. This one, and we want to change the levels of just a bit, just a tad. And stick that to 50 and just see what happens. Okay. Alright. Okay. Yeah. Alright. Alright, hopefully maybe this will work this time. I hope it does. God forbid. I would really like to play this game. Alright. What the hell with it? Let's just go for it. Let's just see what happens. Neat loading screen anyway. Very neat. And watch the game crash or something. We'll get the internet set up and then the game will just go straight to hell. Yeah, so here I guess we've got a little introduction to our three primary characters, as it were, and their mission.
Isaac, it's me. I wish I could talk to you. I'm sorry. I'm sorry about everything. I wish I could just talk to someone. It's all falling apart here. I can't believe what's happening. Strange. Such a little thing.
How many times you watched that thing? Guess
many
you really miss her.
Many times
Don't
I want.
Don't worry, we're almost there. You'll be able to look her up once we're on board.
Okay.
Sounds like you do have a lot of catching up to do.
Right, everyone, we're here. Sinking our orbit now.
All this trouble over that chunk of rock.
Deep space mining is a lucrative business, Ms. Daniels. Aegis-7 is a gold mine, according to Prospector's reports.
Now, frankly, this is already my first big issue with the game. It starts with this, extended...
There she is.
I don't really understand this, basically. I get to sit down in a chair...
So that's Ishimura.
...and watch our,
G, Ishimura.
...encounter with the Ishimura. And, I've got... the option of looking around, sort of, but...
I don't see any running lights.
Corporal, take us in closer and hail them.
Which, by the way, I don't really think we have to really go too much into plot in this game. There's not a whole lot going on, frankly.
USG Ishimura, this is the emergency maintenance team of the USG Kellyan responding to your distress call. Come in, Ishimura.
There you go. There's a story right there. Ishimura sends out a distress call. This ship's being sent in to check it out. And our main character, Isaac Clarke, is a engineer, as it were, which,
never heard of a total
oddly enough, has a lot more going on in the gameplay than you would
think.
But yeah, so we're coming to see if what's going on and what sort of trouble the ship's in. What is that? I don't know. It's probably not a fucking monster.
Sounds like they're having problems with their encoder. You get us down there, and Isaac and I can fix it. 48 hours max.
Yeah, no, semi-human. Grunting sounds an awful lot like static nowadays, man. She's a real genius.
Automatic docking procedures a go.
What the hell?
Sir, the auto dock.
What is it?
We're off track. We're gonna hit the hull.
Hit the blast chutes. That guidance tether's damaged. Switch to manual now.
I just think this is a complete way. I mean, like, really, I could see this working better as just a cutscene because I don't really understand the point of holding me in one spot while I can look around. It does not immediately equate to immersion. All it equates to is, wow, I really wish I could do something. Wowie zowie. A lot of shit going on. Wish I could just walk around the ship. God, I wish I could look at stuff, you know.
Is everyone okay?
I'm not. I'd like to get up.
What the hell were you thinking? Were you trying to get us killed?
Nope.
You just saved our asses, Ms. Daniels.
Huh. It's weird. Isaac Clarke looks like Billy Corgan. It's really odd.
I'm not getting any readings from the port booster, and we've lost comms and autopilot. It'll take some time to fix.
All right. Let's get some extra hands from flight deck to help out.
Still won't let me...
Hold still, Isaac. I'm thinking of everyone's wreck with the ship.
Honey, I just want to walk.
Okay, we're done.
Thank you.
Help for everyone.
Wonderful.
All right. We've still got a job to do. We're moving out.
Okay. So, yeah, this is... Thankfully, this is not indicative of the whole game, thankfully. Once we get full control over Isaac Clarke and not just his ability to look around, at least in the time I've played so far, not really a whole lot of... I don't really think there's much of any point where the game's suddenly like, oh, you need to just walk through here and look around while we have a comm link up or something like that, you know? Okay, so... Just as a word of advice to anybody actually looking to play this on PC, because it did kind of throw me for a loop initially. When running the game on all its highest settings, it's not a really demanding game at all. But the problem is that EA Redwood Studios, or whomever actually ported this to PC, I assume it was an in-house decision. The actual game itself, when you're running VSync, when you've got that activated in-game, it'll actually lock the game at a strict 30 frames per second, which you'll be seeing this feed running at 30 frames per second. I'm running it at 60. We'll get to this crap in just a minute. There is a big, big issue I have with this. But on that note, to get it to run at 60 frames per second correctly, all you really have to do is you just have to go into the in-game settings for Dead Space, turn off VSync in-game, and then go to your GPU's graphics control user interface, whether you have AMD, I think they use Catalyst, if I'm not mistaken, and then NVIDIA, it's got the NVIDIA control panel. Regardless, you have to manually turn on VSync through your GPU's user interface and not in-game, and if you do that, you'll get a smooth, silky 60 frames per second, and the game will actually look really great. And not to say it looks bad running at 30 frames per second, but there's a considerable, at least to me, there's a considerable difference in terms of just the feel of it. The feel of 60 frames per second. Okay, so on to this little HUD. Okay, so the game's got a really interesting, cool way of dealing with a heads-up display that you normally see in most third-person, you know, action shooters, action games, survival horror, etc. It's all tethered basically to Isaac, whether it's in the form of his spinal health meter. We'll get to the little meter that's right to the right of that here in a bit. Not to mention that he's got a chest piece that doubles as your user interface for your inventory, management, map, mission stuff, database stuff. It's really, 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 really cool. I think it's a really, really neat way of handling the issue of, you know, excessive heads-up display coverage on screen. And as a matter of fact, Resident Evil 6 used this to a great degree and did a really good job of it. Unfortunately, they didn't bother to tell you how to read the heads-up display in that game, so it really kind of almost negates itself. But, however, the issue with this game is not so much how you read the HUD, it's what keeps popping up throughout your adventure regarding the HUD. In the introductory chapter, it's like every 5-10 minutes, you will come across something, or you'll have to go into a room and you'll have to do something where the game will teach you how to do it. It'll pull up a menu which will give you the contextual buttons, this does this, this does that, etc. And as far as I can tell, I probably haven't done enough digging in the options maybe, but I don't believe there's a way to turn it off. So it happens regularly, and it is really obnoxious because of the way it's implemented, not to mention the fact that it's routed to you having to press the A button, but the problem is that the A button may not even work while that HUD is up, because there's a certain... here we go again. Wonderful. Notice it won't go away, but then it goes away when I hit A there. Sometimes it'll say, hit A to remove screen or whatever, and it won't, so... It's just really clumsy. I think in terms of everything else you see in the game regarding heads-up display and contextual menus, that is by far one of the clunkiest things I have ever encountered in a game like this. It's very, very disruptive. It takes you right out of the game. It consistently reminds you that you're playing a game. You know, which I guess is kind of not a big deal. I mean, obviously I'm playing a game, but I don't necessarily need to be reminded every 10 minutes. Oh, hey, actually, this button, which you probably think does this, in fact does this. So go ahead and press that for us, please.
There's nobody here. I can't pick up any broadcasts.
Who cares? By the way, again, on the plot, pretty standard sci-fi horror stuff. Very reminiscent of... It's kind of like Alien if the plot of Aliens was in it. I know that doesn't really make a lot of sense, but that's basically the idea. You've got geography, you've got general level layout and design that, and especially in terms of aesthetic, that really harkens back to Ridley Scott's 1979 film Alien. But then at the same time, you also have like this very modern, like semi-military versus science-esque thing going on in here, which is kind of reminiscent of Aliens, the James Cameron sequel. Thankfully, there's no specific space marine, though. I'm not even entirely sure what these guys are. I think they're just sort of like a security detail, but they're not really, like, military. So that's kind of nice. And, of course, here we are. Game really wants me to press a button, of course. But yeah, I just figured I'd kind of mention that, because that is one of the best positives I can actually give this game, is just the general design aesthetic. The look of the game, the feel of the game in terms of its mood, its atmosphere. Yeah, it's really, it's pulling so much from Alien, it's like immensely, but at the same time, even though it is kind of just flat out copy-pasting some of that stuff into this, you don't see that a lot in video games regardless, so it does kind of stick out, and it's a good thing. It's a good thing. So let me go ahead and hit this button. Objective complete, you're going to see that. You can see that a lot.
System's offline. Getting around is going to be difficult. Air seems to be flowing again. That's a start.
Now, eventually here in the next little bit... Well, this happens, first of all. I guess
what
this is kind of exciting.
That?
Automatic quarantine must have tripped when the filtration system restarted.
This is actually an interesting design decision. This occurs repeatedly throughout the game. It's actually really neat. Very tense.
I don't know. Something's in the room with us.
Woo!
Jesus! Overfire!
Woo! Scary. So yeah, you'll notice like the really cool lighting effects going on in here, which I think are pretty neat. Okay. Oh yeah, and I can run now, which is really neat. I think I got... Yeah. Woo! He done be right behind me! So yeah, honey, I'm running. That's cool. Second time that's happened. Second time I've run through that and I got hit by the monster. And I think you're actually supposed to take some form of damage from it. Hell, I kind of lost track of what I was going to say.